This kind of hit me on a Friday night. You know, when we go Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays are when most people are most joyful, cheerfulness root for their team. See where I'm going with it? Loud and proud. But when it comes Sunday, we sit here like bumps on a log. There's no emotion. There is no, it's like we just walk straight and it's the same thing over and over. It's like a pattern that you go through like cows. We had a farm, we ran about 100 head of cattle. They all knew where we fed them. They all knew where the hay was, and they all knew where the water was. Mm-hmm. So what'd they do? They followed one by one by one whenever they would go. When one would lead, the other one would follow. So I went to the game Friday night. And I was on the picking side. I'm actually a PRC guy, but you know, hey, we're going to support locals going to state.
Well, she got her cover on. At least the women.
But what gets me is that you have these people that are, you have families there with young kids, young adults, teenagers that are on a path that is going to lead to an issue. I'm not saying football is bad. Don't get me wrong at all. I love football. An Ole Miss fan.
We'll pray for you.
But what I'm trying to say is that when you can go Friday night and just scream and shout for a pigskin.
That's right. Go ahead.
A pigskin that was handmade that did not save your soul.
That's right.
Did not save your soul. Let me bring you up to another thing. And I'm so glad of this. There's five man-made things in heaven. It's the only man-made things in heaven that will be in heaven. Think about it. Palms. Feet. Side. I just hit five, didn't I? That's the only man-made things in heaven. But we'll get loud and proud for a pigskin on a Friday night, on a Saturday, when your team scores that touchdown, or when your team does that interception. We're going to scream and shout, but we can't come into this church that God has made for us to worship.
Amen.
And have any enthusiasm.
That's right.
Have any enthusiasm. So when the preacher comes up here, and the preacher is going to give you a message that came from the throne.
Amen.
That's right.
But we're all going to sit there just like the same routine. It's like a check mark. Check. Went to church today. Praise God. Let's go home and eat. Popeye sounds great. But there's one thing that happened that day when our Savior carried his cross. Right before he got up there. Now you gotta imagine, he had to carry it as he was being whipped, as he was being hit, as he was being spit on. He carried his own cross.
Yeah.
He stumbled and fell before he made it. Buckley, you know what? Yeah, I gotta say, me in the spirit, me in the flesh here, I'd have been like, heck with this dude. God, I'm going home. But he didn't do it.
No.
What did he do?
He
stumbled. He fell to the ground. He got back up. And he carried his cross, one, for us.
That's right.
Because he knew that what he had to do was die on that and covered us. There is one thing I do know, is that Satan cannot cross the bloodline.
That's right.
He can't cross it. If you are a child of God, everything has to go through him before it gets to you. He's already plowed the field before you. He's already plowed the path. He's already made everything. But we have to walk in faith that he has taken care of already. I used to work at Stennis, had a stroke. I was told I was damaged goods. Lost my job, damaged goods. What if God would have said, you're damaged goods and you're worthless to us? You're worthless. Guys, do we understand that if he did not get back up when he fell on that cross, there would be no heaven. There would be, most importantly, all no salvation for us as sinners. There would be no salvation. There would be no blood that Satan couldn't cross. So I was sitting there that Friday, and I was like, man, I didn't even get into ball games, but I was sitting there looking. I was looking. It's a state game, you know, they're going to the playoffs next week. If they win, they go play for the state championship. But what is the true? What is true champion? Did that pigskin pay the ultimate price? Did them players on the field pay the ultimate price? Oh, you'll hear them on ESPN. Oh, man, you know, I paid the ultimate price. I know I took that hit. Guys, that ain't nothing compared to what our Savior did.
That's right.
That's right.
Our Savior bled for me, bled for you, 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 all of them. And he did it and with knowing from the day he was born to the day that he knew he was going to end up on Calvary, he knew his path. He knew what the outcome was going to be. He knew Satan was going to be beaten at his own game.
That's right.
But we still come in Sunday. We sit on our pew. We raise our little book. And we sing. Where's your enthusiasm? Where is that just grip a hold of you? Thank you, God. Raise your hands in the air. Thank you for saving me, God. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Why can't we raise our hands? Why can't we stand up? And why can't we give the same enthusiasm that we give on a Friday night or a Saturday over a pigskin?
Amen.
Amen.
Why? Why is it so hard? Have we gotten that hard shell that it doesn't matter anymore? That we just walk through the motions? That we just check it off?
I went to church, praise God.
Or do we actually come in here and do we actually go, God, thank you. Just thank you. God, thank you for the week. God, thank you for allowing me to walk another day on this earth that you creation. Thank God I ain't pushing up daisies.
Amen.
Life is precious. We don't know how long we have. We're not vapor. We're here 1 minute and gone the next. We're a vapor.
Yep.
Why are we going to walk through the motions at church? And why are we just going to be all this, all that? When a church is a refuge, a church is a place that when we are outside going through the week and the devil's on us, the devil has pushed us and pushed us and pushed us, we feel that there's no way to get around it. We are weak. Our spirits are low. Why can't we come to the house of refuge here, get on our our spirit refilled. Because if you don't have your spirit refilled on a Sunday, you're surely not going to make it through Monday and the following week. So as I had somebody ask me, I had a teenager say to me, said, Mike, I got a question. You talk about praise and worship, and what is praise? What is praise? You know the definition of praise? Bragging on God.
No way.
Yeah.
What is worship?
This is where everybody gets it wrong. This is like no one thing. They're like, hey man, we just sit here and sing. No.
Worship is loving on the Father that died on the cross for you.
That's right.
Worship is loving on God. That's it. It's simple. So I said, well, Mike, better back this up. You better come with it. Better be able to say something about it. David. What did David do? What's the thing that David had no problem doing?
He could write the Psalms.
He had no problem. He danced. He had his hands in the air. He was grateful for the Holy King, the Holy of Holies, the Great I Am, the Lamb of God. He danced. He raised his hands. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you. And he did it because he knew who he was serving. He did it because it was natural. Because why? He was worshiping. And what did I just tell you worshiping was? Loving on God. He was loving on God. Worshiping God. Now, I'm going to ask every each one of y'all, just close your eyes. Just close your eyes for a minute. Don't worry about me. Don't worry about what I'm fixing to do. Just close your eyes. Search yourself. Search what you got. Search if you have been what you needed to be.
Thank you.
My chains are gone. He has set me free. That is the best thing there, that your chains are gone, that he set you free. You no longer have to worry about them chains whenever you are born again Christian, whenever God has reached way down, wherever you may be, at your lowest of lowest, and picked you up and dusted you off and set your mind. And set your mind. And he sets you free of the chains that hold you and bind you. Addiction can't bind you. The devil can't bind you. None of the earthly things can bind you, because he set that free the day that he put it as far as the east is from the west.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
That cannot come and touch you. Now, am I saying when you're a Christian that nothing is going to bother you, that things are not going to come at you? No, but I'm telling you that it has to go through the Almighty before it gets to you.
That's right.
And I'm so glad to know that when he stumbled on that cross, stumbled carrying that cross, that he picked it up and he carried on. And we know when we get to heaven and the five man-made things, will always be a reminder the price he paid on Calvary. Because the price he paid on Calvary is the ultimate sacrifice. It was not the pigskin. It was not the linebacker that got hit. What I'm trying to tell you is that coming to this house is a house of worship. It's a house of praise. This is a house to be refilled, to have your spirit filled up again. Because the days that we go through, they drain us spiritually. But if you're just going to come in here and sit on a pew to take a spot just because that's what we were taught to do, and that's what we have done our entire lives, I will tell you this, please leave. Leave. I don't want to talk to you. I don't want to waste my breath, because why? If it hasn't gotten here, and you're just checking off, going through the motions, happy-go-lucky, then you're not here for the right reasons.
That's right.
And I tell teenagers every week when I see them, if you're not there for the right reasons, there's the door. Leave it. Because I'm sure I can find somebody else that will walk through that door and need what is given freely in America by the one and only that died on that cross.
Amen.
Amen.
So if we're just here to just sit on a pew to take up space, go home and watch Sunday football. Go home and watch the pregame. It starts at 11 o'clock. Don't come and waste the church's time, the time of whenever you get refilled.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Amen.